rectangle using these two sides like this?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go up to the top right there.
Uh-huh. And so what does the inside of this rectangle represent?
One.
This part right here?
Oh, no, it represents the 7 and I mean the 7 and the 5.
It represents 35 units.
Well, let's say, before we even figure out the answer, is it represents the answer. It represents 7 tenths times 5 sevenths. Okay? Alright. So it's the area of this square. Because this is 1 by 1. And the area is how many squares fit. Okay? So how many squares will fit? 1 square will fit in this 1 by 1 square.
70.
So the area is 1. If we're just trying to figure out how much of this square does this little rectangle take up, we just need to say what fraction of the square that rectangle is. And a fraction, if you remember, let's use this for example. What does the 10 tell us about this number, 7 tenths? Seven represents? Yes?
How many pieces you have?
Okay, how many do you have? How many pieces do you have? Right, it's not enough to just say seven. You can't say I have seven. Seven what? Seven pieces. Seven pieces where 10 of those pieces make up the whole thing. So in our fraction of the square we're trying to figure out, we have to figure out first how many pieces make up the whole thing. We can see that pretty easily when we look at how many pieces this is cut into, how many pieces this is cut into, how many pieces is the whole thing cut into. How many pieces make up this square? Yeah.
70.
Yeah, there are 10 going this way, there are 7 going this way, so altogether 70 is how many make up the whole square. Here we need to know how many we have. Which we have 35. We have 7 going this way and 5 going this way. Okay. Now 7 times 5, that's not the area because the area is how many squares fit. These are not squares. These are little rectangles. Because okay? These pieces are like a little bit shorter than these ones. Well, these ones are a little bit shorter than these ones because we have to fit more of them into that one hole in there. So 5 by 7 tells us that 35 is how many of those pieces we have. What's that?
One half.
Simplifies the 1/2. Divide this by 35. Divide by 35. Divide this by 35. And we get 1/2.
But then wouldn't we have to make the number line? Like that's 1 to 0. Like we would have the 0 and then the 1 at the end of it.
For why would we be doing that?
I don't know, because that's what we did before.
Well, I made two number lines. I made a number line here from 0 to 1, right? Cut it into 10 pieces and show you 7 of them.
Yeah, but like, you know how we had the one where it was just the 1 and then we had the little spaces in between it to add up to 1? Would we do that here, or would it be already done for us because we've already done the top, the side, and the top one?
You mean for the 1/2?
Yeah.
If we wanted to show 1/2 and be able to see 1/2, how big 1/2 is, then yeah. But I mean that's not something we have to do normally. Like what this is really representing is I give you the fractions 7/10 and 5/7 and I say to multiply them together, right? And how do we multiply fractions? Straight across. The purpose behind this is not to change that in any way. I'm not trying to change the way you multiply fractions and that you multiply them straight across. Keep multiplying fractions straight across. Keep simplifying them. Keep doing all that stuff. What is the point of all this? Fractions work the way they do. This is the how many you have, this is how many it takes to make the whole. Why does multiplying the numerators together and the denominators together give us the product of those two fractions? Right? Because it counts up all those things. It counts up how many make the new whole and how many of those little pieces you have. It's very clear in this picture. And that's what the purpose of the picture is. And that's it. Not change anything about how you multiply fractions together. By understanding how why fractions multiply the way they do, later, when I ask you to learn how to multiply okay, I want you to multiply those two together. If you did not understand fully why you would multiply fractions straight across, that's just like a shaky memory of how you're supposed to multiply fractions, and you get to this, and you're still confused about how to multiply fractions or why you multiply fractions the way you do, you're still trying to cross-multiply them, or you don't fully understand how to simplify a fraction, all those kinds of things, it's going to make it that much more difficult. So before we get onto that, and before we arrive on this day when you multiply these together, and you don't remember how to multiply fractions together, and I have to walk you back to, well, here are two fractions. Fractions are still what fractions are. We still multiply fractions together the way we multiply fractions together. Right? So that's how we can explain why fractions multiply the way they do. Any questions about that? It's a nice little thing that makes it pretty simple. You don't have to think too hard about it. It counts all that stuff. Start with, let's look at what happens a lot of times, the mistake that happens a lot. Someone will say that this is, what do you think they probably say it is if they're thinking the wrong answer? What's that?
6 times.
5, oh, they might multiply, that could happen. More often, you know, they will make the multiplication problem, they'll add the numerators, they'll add the denominators. So, first of all, doing that doesn't make a lot of sense. It makes not very much sense for the reason that this does not make much sense. The 5 apples plus 1 orange is 6 apple oranges. Okay. Because why can you not add 5 apples and 1 orange? What's the problem with that? Yeah?
They're not the same.
They're not the same thing. What are they? They're different things. Apples and oranges are different things. What are the different things we're adding together here? Clint?
Different denominators.
Okay, different denominators. But we talked about what those denominators mean, right?
What?
Any other crack here, Clint?
What it's out of.
What it's out of?
The pieces that make the whole.
What's that?
Pieces that make the whole.
Okay, the pieces that make the whole. Here's sixths, and here are fourths, right? These sixths are a certain size. These fourths are a different size. They're different sizes. So to add 5 of these things to one of these things that are different sizes, and to say you have 6, is the same as saying 6 apple oranges. What are those things? Why would they be 10s? Can you just add a 6 and a 4th and you're a 10? If I add a 6 and a 4, I'm really adding up how many make up the entire whole. So I don't really get, I can't really get anything because they're not the same thing. So let's see that. I'm going to show you how they're two different things. Okay. So sixths, here we have fourths. Talking about two, three, four, five of them here, and one of them here. So if we can remember what we learned about fractions, what they're trying to say, if the denominators are saying, oh, I'm six pieces make the whole, I'm four pieces make the whole, okay? To try and add them together and say I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and six of them now makes as much sense, you know, visually as it does to make five apples and one orange, six of oranges. Okay. So totally different things. So how then do we make different things into the same thing? Don't tell me what to do with these fractions, tell me what to do with these pieces. What to do with these pieces to make them the same thing?
You have to make them so they both have the exact same number of pieces.
Make them the same thing, right? If I could figure out how to cut these up into the same number of pieces, then, well, then I could add them up, right? So, take a look at it and think, well, there's, I can take each of these pieces and cut them into a certain amount, and I can take each of these pieces, cut them up the same way, and then I'll have, you know, the same size pieces here. Each of these, like if I were to cut each of these into three pieces, then, well, they'd all be the same size, right? That'd be fine, it'd just be a different way to cut it up. Cut each of these into seven pieces, then I have 28 pieces, and, well, that's a different number of pieces. But how can I cut this into this a little bit differently? Like, what number of pieces could I wind up with that are the same? How many pieces could I cut them both into?
12.
So to cut this piece, this pie or whatever, into a total of 12 pieces, I'll go to every piece and do what with it? Molly?
Split it in half.
Split it in half. Make two pieces out of every piece that I see. So if I had six pieces to start with, I cut each of them into two. Now I've doubled the number of pieces, and they've gotten smaller, but the number of them is doubled. So I have 12 pieces. Now here's four, and I'm going to cut each of those into how many pieces? Into three pieces each. Cut that into three pieces, and this into three pieces, this into three pieces, this into three pieces. So they cut those four pieces into three pieces each, and have four groups of three out of 12 pieces altogether. So now each of these pies is made of 12 pieces, and at the same time that I was cutting up those, all of the pieces, cutting up all six pieces, I, of course, cut up the five that I have. So I cut this into 12, so the number of pieces that it takes to make the whole has doubled, and the number of pieces that I have has doubled. Same over here, the number of pieces that it takes to make the whole is three times what it used to be, and the number of pieces that I have is three times what it used to be. So this is doubled, and this is doubled. This has been tripled. And the number of pieces that I have, triple. Now, if I multiply the denominator by 2 and the numerator by 2, I've done something. I've multiplied 5 sixths by 2 over 2, right? Mm-hmm. We know what matrix, or not matrix, fraction multiplication, straight across. We just got done talking about that. We convinced ourselves that it's correct to multiply fractions straight across. So if I multiply 5 by 2 and 6 by 2, what I've really done is multiply by 2 over 2, then what is this fraction equal to? Yeah?
1.
Very good. It's equal to 1. Can I multiply a number by 1? Mm-hmm. I can't multiply a number by 1. That is completely allowable. If I multiply a number by 1, what do I get? Same thing. Nothing's changed. Just get 5 times 1 is 5, 2 times 1 is 1, is 2, 7 times 1 is 7. Same thing here. We multiply by 3 over 3, we're really multiplying by 1. So the outlining this and showing you this picture shows you that we have not changed how big this stuff we have is, right? Whether we have 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sixths, or we have 10, 12, so it's the same thing. We just cut the pieces into more pieces. We haven't brought anything in or taken anything away. Same thing when we multiply by 1. So we get 10. ten twelfths plus three twelfths, it's 13 twelfths. And probably a lot of you, one and one twelfth. Okay? When it comes down to it, I do not care if you give me an answer of 13 twelfths or one and one twelfth. They both are good answers depending on the context. If I'm wanting to know how many gallons of milk I have, I want to hear one and a twelfth, right? But I won't mark you down for saying 13 twelfths if I do. The thing about this is, say I want to multiply 3/4 by 1 and 1 12th. I want to multiply those together. What's the first thing you do? Yeah?
You do, I forgot what you call it, but for the mixed number, you do 12 plus, no, times 1 plus 1.
There you go.
And then
13 twelfths.
Yeah.
Right? 13 twelfths. First, you turn it into an improper fraction, and then you multiply straight across. So, which one's better is hard to say. If I ever want to multiply this by something or add it to something, I'm just going to turn it right back into the improper fraction and then use it. It's most useful in this form. It's got maybe a little more, it's easier to understand the information in it if it's a mixed number. Together, just make sure we've got this down. What's our common denominator?
35.
So multiply this by 7. This by 7. Whatever pi this is cutting up, it's in 5 pieces total, okay? But that's different from being in 7 pieces total, so we can't add them up. So we cut this each piece into 7 pieces each, which of course we had to do to the 3 pieces that are shaded in. We couldn't do anything different. We'd have to make this 7 times as much, multiply by 7 over 7. Okay. And if we divide each of these into 5 pieces each, we'll have a total of 35 pieces in this pi as well, which of course we'll have to multiply, cut each of those pieces into 5 pieces as well. We have 21 35ths plus 20 35ths is 41 35ths, which is where I would leave it. Further if you want, get 1 and what?
6/35.
Okay. Seems like you're good on that, so I'm just going to go ahead. Get 3/4 divided by it. It's a fraction divided by a fraction. See, you get that. What we're going to do with this is we're going to take some stuff that we've already kind of proven is true and works. Sure, where to start, or you remember there's something about taking a fraction divided by a fraction, or just anytime you divide, you don't have to divide a fraction by a fraction, but dividing by a fraction, anything by a fraction, there's something about multiplying, something about reciprocals. I'm not looking for a right answer here.
Yeah, not yet.
Okay. The most common things that I see is either like we haven't started, we didn't even try, or I'll see 3/4 times h fifths. Or I'll see 4/3 times 5/8. Remember, there's something about multiplying, something about reciprocal. Okay? So which of these is it?
It's the first one.
First one? Why?
Because you have to, I don't know if it's called reciprocal, but flip the fraction upside down because you can't divide it, so you have to divide it.
You can divide it by 4. You can make it simplified by if you divide 4. And get that down to 1.
Well, my question is, I'm hearing words like flip and reciprocal.
Yeah.
So why don't I flip or reciprocal the top fraction? You don't know why?
No, I didn't really
see
that before.
I mean, if we remember to flip the denominator fraction and multiply, like, fine. And now, it doesn't take much for us to see, at least if I get confused and I think it's this, this, and it can't remember which it is, but I see it all the time, right, trying to figure out, is it this one or is it this one? A student will pull me aside, he's like, do I multiply by the reciprocal of the denominator or the reciprocal of the numerator? I can't remember, okay? So I'm just gonna show you real quick something you can do to, it's not a memory trick or anything like that, it's just kind of what you're really doing, what you're shortcutting and kind of forgetting, all right? So, 3/4 over 5/8, that's a fraction, right? It's got its main middle line there, all right? Can I multiply this fraction by something?
No. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can multiply by something? What can I multiply
the
by?
The reciprocal of the...
No, I'm talking about this whole fraction. This over this times another number.
Can you times it by 1?
Yes, I can times it by 1. I don't want to multiply by anything else, because if I just multiply by 2, right, now it's not the same. It's not the same number anymore. So I'm going to multiply it by 1. I'm going to multiply it by a helpful version of 1. Okay. I'm going to multiply it by a number over itself, like we did to find common denominators. And I'm going to do it in such a way that the denominator here, that's something really convenient. All right. I'm going to multiply by the reciprocal of the denominator here and up here. You might recognize this as, you know, the answer. We'll be done when we multiply those two together. But just real quickly, we'll see why for sure that's true. And what happens if we accidentally do the opposite? In the denominator, what do I get when I multiply 5/8 by 8/5?
1.
You get 1. You get either, you know, cross-canceling, if you think that way, or you get 40 over 40. Either way, in the denominator, you get 1. Now, whatever this is, what happens when you divide it by 1?
It stays.
17 divided by 1, 17, 20 divided by 1, 20, whatever it is, 4/5, whatever it is, divided by 1 is just itself. So here we multiply. We know how to multiply fractions now. We multiply straight across. This is the number of the whole. This is the number of them that we have. So we have 24 20ths. Yeah, 24 twentieths divided by 1 is 24 twentieths. 24 twentieths. And we can simplify 24 twentieths. We can divide them both by 4, get 6/5. Or 1/5. Right? So that's a real quick little thing that if you ever think, is it the reciprocal, the numerator, or denominator, then you're definitely not the first person to wonder that. And you can remind yourself which way it goes. Yeah.
But why do we do this?
Well, I have an answer. I'm not sure if it's going to answer your question. I'm not sure what you're doing. It's easier to multiply fractions than to divide them.
Okay.
Like we just kind of revert back to something that is pretty simple operation, multiplying straight across. Does that answer your question? If you turn it into multiplication, it's easier.
No, like, I'm wondering why you would do the reciprocal in the first place. Like, I understand of why you would do it on the bottom, but why do you do it at all?
Well, if you were trying to divide 3/4 by 5/8, it would be a pretty tricky thing to conceptualize. So you get this 3/4. Okay, so here's 1 divided into 4 pieces. Here's 3/4. Okay, I'm going to divide it by 5/8. I'm going to divide it into groups dividing it into four groups, okay, but to divide it into 5/8, and then we have to kind of, you know, haven't even really thought about what that would look like in a while, okay? When we divide by fractions, strange things happen. Because we know that we're going to take this thing that's less than one, divide it by something, a fraction that's less than one, actually wind up with something that's bigger than one. Trying to figure out how to divide it, I don't know, it's kind of tricky. So the idea of multiplying 3/4 by 8/5, it's much easier to do than to divide by 5/8. So I guess, like, maybe, are you asking where did someone get the idea to do that in the first place?
Yeah,
or?
I guess we're kind of like when you were explaining how, like, area is squares, or why we add fractions the way we do. I'm just wondering, like, why would you do the reciprocal?
So why, like, in math history would somebody have ever done that?
Yeah.
Well, I think you start with, it's easier, right? So one day somebody realized that doing this division or doing this multiplication is equivalent. They thought, I'd much rather do this. So they kind of, sometimes we are lucky because somebody came up with a really good idea in the past and we just keep doing that good idea.
Okay.
Right? Even the
it just
idea.
Turns out that way, that's why you do it like that.
Well, kind of think of other instances where this works, but I don't have a good example of something else that I could say very easily. But sometimes you have like a math thing that you want to do, and it turns out it's the same as doing some other easier thing, right?
Okay.
It's mathematically equivalent.
So it just
somebody
works.
Proves that, well, we can see that it works just by doing this, right?
Yeah.
Multiply by one, this is one. Notice that it works, and then we say, well, that's a lot easier. I'm going to do it that way from now on, because it's easier.
Okay.
And even things that you might not think about, like writing 2,354 like this, if you've been doing it for so long, you don't realize how much easier it is than it used to be, right? If I wanted to write this as an ancient Roman, I would have to write, I don't even know if I'll remember, but 2,000. 300, is that C? That's C. 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 300. 50, I think it's L.
Yeah.
And then 4, I go 1, and then a 5. So now I wrote 2,354, and then, you know, if I was Roman, I probably would have done it more quickly. But then arithmetic with these numbers is just awful. Okay? Doing this is much better, and there's not this whole subtracting the 1 from the 5 that's 4. Like arithmetic with these numbers in this way, where each one represents a new power of 10, right? 10, 10 times 10, 10 times 10 times 10, and so on. Like, who did that? Who would have ever thought to do that?
Yeah.
Who? Well, they're called Arabic numerals. Okay? So it came from that part of the world, the Arab world. And it was brought by a guy named Fibonacci. You guys recognize the name Fibonacci?
Yay.
He brought it in the early 1400s to the Romans, and he had to convince them to stop using Roman numerals and to use the numerals we use today. And it was kind of a hard sell. They, like, weren't really excited about changing the way they wrote numbers. But it made arithmetic so much easier. Okay? Who would have thought of it? Some smart guy. Just sometime in the past. Right? And that's where we are sometimes. Somebody just thought of something really cool and we piggyback on their idea.
Let's get back on track.
Yeah.
Don't we do?
Okay. Alright. Oh, just really quickly. If you were to multiply by the reciprocal of the numerator here, then you would get 1 over. Backwards. Six divided by two is negative three.
Yeah.
Six divided by two is negative three. Okay. If six divided by two is negative three, that means two times negative three is six. It's not. Two times negative three is negative six.
Yeah.
Okay. Negative times positive is negative. Otherwise, everything else is the same. Two times three is six. Two times negative three is negative six. Okay. So first, let's just go to six divided by two. What's six divided by two? Right or this
right.
Is wrong. I'm just
matter.
Following what someone told me to do.
What is right?
Just
what is
to
the right answer?
Let me clear this up.
Which one's the right answer?
We'll come back to it and I'll talk about it with you.
What?
Let's do this. Is yeah. This means divide, or it means. I guess you can see that as a fraction too. But fractions are division as well.
So
I hear 0.6 repeating.
Oh, one.
Numbers, and you get some decimals. Right. Do we get any other answers besides 0.6 repeating?
2/3.
This is 2/3. 2/3 are 0.6 repeating. Anything else?
Oh, my
negative goes right here.
I got it.
Okay. What if I said that I got 6? This problem right here.
I got
288. I learned about it in 5 years ago. Some whatever that was. And I follow certain YouTubers and one of them put this problem up there and said, please help me, I'm stuck on this problem. Now he's the guy who does calculus and partial differential equations tutorials, so he's probably not really struggling. So I was trying to figure out, what's going on? Why is he putting this up there? And I looked at the comments, and it only been up for a few hours, and there were people, cussing at each other in the comments, getting really mad, saying, this is the right answer, this is why, this is how I know I'm right. Most of the answers were, this is how you're supposed to do it, okay? But that's what I'm talking about. again, but I'm gonna change one little thing. Get two different answers?
Yeah.
No. Okay. So next class.